Hello everyone, I am Dr. Prashant, and in this presentation we will talk about the causes, diagnosis and management of Budd-Chiari syndrome. Before we move on to the description of Budd-Chiari syndrome, let us discuss the applied anatomy of the liver and its surrounding structures. This is the liver, this is the hepatic vein, this is the splenic vein, the superior mesenteric vein. The splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein join to form the portal vein, which is seen here. This is the common bile duct and this is the gallbladder. The definition of Budd-Chiari syndrome is that it represents the obstruction of the hepatic veins or the terminal inferior vena cava. Budd-Chiari syndrome may be classified into two types. There is primary Budd-Chiari syndrome, in which there is obstruction from within the lumen of the hepatic vein, or there could be secondary Budd-Chiari syndrome, in which there is obstruction from outside the lumen of the hepatic vein. Let's now discuss the epidemiology of Budd-Chiari syndrome. A prevalence of 1.4 per million population with a slight female preponderance is seen. However, the incidence in Asian countries is higher, in that according to one case series, the cause of liver-related admissions in a two-year period in Nepal was Budd-Chiari syndrome in up to 17% of the cases. The risk factors for Budd-Chiari syndrome include myeloproliferative neoplasms, JAK2 mutation, antiphospholipid syndrome, systemic disease such as connective tissue disease, Behçet's, and human immunodeficiency virus, the factor V Leiden syndrome, and recent oral contraceptive pill use. The causes of Budd-Chiari syndrome include hypercoagulable states, infections, malignancies, and miscellaneous causes. The hypercoagulable states in Budd-Chiari syndrome include the antiphospholipid syndrome, antithrombin deficiency, factor V Leiden deficiency, the methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase mutations, myeloproliferative neoplasms, oral contraceptives, paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, postpartum thrombocytopenic purpura, pregnancy, protein CNS deficiency, prothrombin gene mutations, and sickle cell disease. Infections causing Budd-Chiari syndrome include aspergillosis, syphilis, filariasis, tuberculosis, hydatid cysts, schistosomiasis, liver abscess, and pelvic cellulitis. Malignancies causing Budd-Chiari syndrome include adrenal carcinoma, hepatocellular carcinoma, leiomyosarcoma, leukemia, lung cancer, myxomas, renal carcinoma, and rhabdomyosarcoma. The miscellaneous causes of Budd-Chiari syndrome include Behçet's disease, celiac disease, dacarbazine therapy, inflammatory bowel disease, laparoscopic cholecystectomy, polycystic liver disease. The clinical spectrum of Budd-Chiari syndrome can range from completely asymptomatic to fulminant hepatic failure. This spectrum may be interspersed by symptoms such as ascites, abdominal pain and fever, and the entire spectrum of complication in liver disease, which include GI bleed, bacterial infections, hepatorenal syndrome and hepatic encephalopathy are possible. Lab investigations may show abnormality in the SGOT and SGPT, creatinine, bilirubin, and the patient may also have coagulopathy. The diagnosis of Budd-Chiari syndrome includes a Doppler ultrasound, computed tomography, and magnetic resonance imaging, although all these modalities are very infrequently required. The appearance on these modalities may be as follows. There could be lack of visibility of the hepatic veins and terminal IVC. Because of the obstruction, the terminal part of the hepatic veins may not be visualized on the imaging modalities as discussed. Budd-Chiari syndrome may also present as an upstream dilatation due to complete or partial obstruction. There could also be diffuse narrowing and irregularity in the hepatic veins and surrounding structures. There could also be transformation into a cord-like remnant, in that the hepatic veins could be visualized as shown here. There could also be combination of atrophy and hypertrophy along with segment 1 enlargement. Furthermore, there could be ascites, portosystemic collaterals, and splenic enlargement. This is because of back pressure changes resulting in splenomegaly. The liver may also show patchy enhancement in the arterial and portal phase, which disappears in the late phase. There could also be marked nodular enhancement in the arterial phase with disappearance in the portal and late phases. Of the diagnostic modalities for Budd-Chiari syndrome, Doppler ultrasound has excellent sensitivity for diagnosis. Magnetic resonance imaging is an alternative to Doppler ultrasound and is not always required. Other diagnostic modalities include liver biopsy, which is not required for diagnosis except in cases where only small hepatic veins are thrombosed, and direct or retrograde venography is almost never required for diagnosis. The evaluation of Budd-Chiari syndrome begins with history and clinical examination, imaging for secondary Budd-Chiari syndrome, complete blood count and JAK2 status, and a bone marrow should be considered if JAK2 status is negative. We can also do flow cytometry for paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, factor 5 and prothrombin gene mutations, lupus anticoagulant and beta-2 glycoprotein 1 antibodies, and identification of one causative agent should not preclude the search for other causes, because more than half of these patients will have more than one cause. The treatment of Budd-Chiari syndrome consists of anticoagulation with low molecular weight heparin or unfractionated heparin along with oral anticoagulation. It is also important to treat the underlying systemic disease which may have contributed to Budd-Chiari syndrome. Percutaneous angioplasty is a subject of debate, and symptomatic patients with venous lesions amenable to angioplasty may be considered for this intervention. When above interventions have failed, the patient can be considered for a TIPS procedure or a portocaval shunt. Finally, liver transplant would form the definitive management in Budd-Chiari syndrome, especially when there is failure of the TIPS or portocaval shunt, or if there is acute liver failure secondary to Budd-Chiari syndrome. Let's discuss the outcomes in Budd-Chiari syndrome. After a median follow-up of 4 years, 20% had succumbed to the illness and 1 in 4 had survived on medical therapy alone. 5% were alive after percutaneous angioplasty. However, 40% were alive because of the TIPS procedure, and 10% were alive after liver transplantation. 85% had received anticoagulation with a 17% bleeding rate. Portal hypertension was the main cause of bleed in such patients, and percutaneous recanalization had excellent results according to some reports. These percentages are likely to change, but overall represent the outcome in Budd-Chiari syndrome. Prognostication in Budd-Chiari syndrome include the Child-Turcotte-Pugh score and the MELD scores, although they have little utility in guiding management of the individual patient. Long-term concerns in patients with Budd-Chiari syndrome include hepatocellular carcinoma and complications of the underlying disease. That's it for our presentation on Budd-Chiari syndrome. Thanks for watching, and we will see you in the next video.